Hey guys, and welcome back to another video on my channel. And if you're new here, welcome, I'm Brianne. Usually on Mondays I post mystery videos, but today's video is just going to be a true crime video. This was my most requested case to cover on this channel, so I thought that we could make a little bit of an exception. And with that being said, let's jump right into this case. Ian Brady was born in 1938 on January 2nd in Glasgow, Scotland to his single mother, Peggy Stewart. Right from the get-go, Ian Brady had a very troubled life. He never knew his father, and right from birth, his mother was very, very poor, and she couldn't afford to take time off work, but she also couldn't afford a babysitter, meaning that she left Ian Brady by himself for long periods of time when he was just a newborn baby. She did this until Ian was around 4 months old, when she gave him up for unofficial adoption. She would visit him regularly until the age of 12 without him knowing that she was actually his biological mother. Eventually, Ian Brady actually moved in with his biological mother and her boyfriend and actually ended up taking his mother's boyfriend last name, which is where the last name Brady comes from. But like I said before, throughout his life, Brady was an extremely troubled child, and at the age of 16, he was actually arrested and put in jail for petty crimes and burglary. In Ian's adult life, he started working as a store clerk in a store in Manchester, and that is where he met Myra Hindley when she started working at the same store as a secretary in 1961. I just want to throw in here that Myra Hindley did not have a troubled life like Ian Brady had. She was described by friends and people who knew her in her younger years that she lived a fairly normal, average lifestyle with her family, and she was never abused or anything like that. Upon meeting Ian Brady, Myra was immediately infatuated with him, and she wrote pages and pages in her diary about how much she loved him and how much she hoped that he would love her back. And eventually, the two began to date and start a relationship. Now, of course, this relationship was not healthy at all, and Ian Brady actually had complete control over Myra, and she started cutting out all of her friends and family. And he had so much control over her that he thought that he was actually a higher power. And when it came to things like paying for the bus, he would always make sure that Myra had paid for him to go on the bus. And if they needed something from the store, he would make Myra go in and buy whatever they needed. And when Brady decided that he needed to have guns, it was up to Myra to join a gun club and illegally get guns for Ian Brady. This soon escalated from Brady just wanting Myra to buy him bus tickets and going to pick up things for the store that he didn't feel comfortable getting, to Brady actually convincing Hindley that rape and torture were the supreme pleasure, in his words. July 12, 1963 would be the day that they would commit their first murder. Ian Brady had instructed Myra to rent a van, and he would drive behind her on a motorcycle, and when he seen a victim that he wanted, he would flash the headlights on the motorcycle to Myra so that she knew to pull over and offer the victim a ride. Brady said that while they were driving, he saw a girl who he wanted to be his first victim, and he had flashed his lights at Hindley to pull over, but she didn't until they had already passed the girl and it was too late. And when Brady had asked Myra Hindley about why she didn't pull over, she said that she'd actually recognized this girl as 8-year-old Marie Roach. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And she was actually her mother's neighbor, and Hindley didn't feel comfortable with this girl being their first victim. The couple then began to look for another victim, and this was just after 8 p.m. when they saw another girl walking down the street in a pale blue coat and high heels. Brady had signaled for Hindley to pull over, and this time she did. Hindley had actually recognized this girl as 16-year-old Paulina Reed, who was Hindley's younger sister's friend. She said that she had felt more comfortable with Paulina being their first victim rather than 8-year-old Marie because she thought that there would be more outrage at a missing 8-year-old rather than a teenager. To lure Paulina into the truck, Myra had actually offered her a ride home. And once Paulina was in the truck, Myra had asked her to come to Saddleworth Moor to help her look for a glove that she had lost, and Paulina agreed. When they arrived at the moor, this is where they met up with Ian Brady. Hindley had introduced Brady to Paulina as her boyfriend, and this is where their stories kind of begin to conflict. Hindley said that she waited in the car while Brady took Paulina out onto the moor, and she waited for him for 30 minutes, and then Brady had come back and took Hindley out to the moor where Paulina had laid dying. Paulina had two severe stab wounds, and Hindley said that her clothes were in disarray, so she had assumed that Brady had sexually assaulted her. But Brady's account said that Hindley had actually participated in the sexual assault of Paulina Reed. And on the couple's way home, they actually encountered Paulina's mother as well as her younger brother who were out searching for Paulina. And if you're wondering why this is called the Moors Murders, it is because they took all of their victims out to Saddleworth Moor to bury them. Also, I just want to throw in here that Myra had made it so easy for the couple to lure in victims. And this is kind of like a really widely known bit of information because Myra was a very average looking woman and there was nothing too alarming about her, so people really trusted her when she had offered them a ride home. On November 23rd, 1963 would be the day that they took their second victim. Myra Hindley lured in 12-year-old John Kilbride by offering him a bottle of sherry. And when he got into the truck, Ian Brady had informed him that the bottle of sherry was actually at their house. And on the way to their house, they had to stop by the moor to search for a glove that Myra had lost. When they arrived at the moor, Brady had taken John out of the van and sexually assaulted him. He then tried to slit his throat, but when that didn't work, he ended up strangling him and burying his body at the moor. Victim number three was Keith Bennett, and he had been lured by the couple when Hindley had offered him a ride home if he had helped her load some boxes into her truck. Again, on the way to drive Keith home, Hindley had asked if he would mind stopping at Saddleworth Moor to search for her lost glove. And when they arrived there, Ian Brady was waiting for him and he took him out of the van and again sexually assaulted him and then murdered him. On December 26, 1964, Hindley and Brady had picked up Leslie Ann Downey. They were on a fairground and when they seen that Leslie was alone, they devised a plan right then and there. They asked the young girl to help them carry some of their many bags from the fairgrounds to their truck and then from the truck to their house. In this case, they actually did bring Leslie Ann Downey to their house, where they tortured her, took sexual photos of her, and videotaped her crying out for her mother. After this, they murdered her, and then the next morning they took her body out to Saddleworth Moor where they buried her. At this point, the couple began to get overly confident and sloppy with their murders. At first, Ian Brady just wanted souvenirs and photos of his victims, but soon that wasn't enough, and he wanted to bring them into his house so that he could prolong the torture. And now that that wasn't enough, he was actually trying to recruit an accomplice. Ian Brady had decided that for his accomplice, he wanted 17-year-old David Smith, who was actually the husband of Myra's younger sister. There was many reasons as to why Ian Brady thought that David Smith would be a good accomplice, but two of the main reasons were: one, David Smith had recently lost a baby, and Ian Brady thought that because he was emotionally vulnerable at this point, that he could overpower David Smith. The second reason was that Ian Brady had actually witnessed David Smith get angry once and lose control, and he thought that he would kind of agree that this was a good way to take out his anger. And that altogether seemed to be enough for Brady to convince him that David Smith would be the perfect accomplice. But Myra wasn't happy about this, and she felt extremely jealous of David Smith because she thought that he was taking Brady away from her. On October 6, 1965, Ian Brady and Myra Hindley had picked up 17-year-old Edward Evans, who was drinking in town that night. And it isn't exactly clear how they lured Edward Evans into their truck to come to their house, but he could have been intoxicated as he was out for the night drinking, and that could be why his guard was down. Once they were back at the house, Hindley had invited over David Smith and purposely led him into the kitchen while Ian Brady was murdering Edward Evans. David Smith helped the couple clean the scene and promised that he would be back the next day to help them dispose of the body. But as soon as David Smith had left the couple's house, he went straight to the phone booth alongside Myra's younger sister to call the police. When police arrived at the home, they said that the couple seemed calm and the house didn't look like a crime scene. Myra Hindley and Ian Brady had actually told the police that Myra's grandmother was sleeping in a locked room upstairs. That is when the police asked for a key to this room. That is where they found the body of Edward Evans propped up in the fetal position and stuffed into a plastic bag. Myra Hindley had tried to blame the whole entire thing on David Smith, but after finding the videos and pictures that the couple had taken of their victims, they knew that it was all Myra Hindley and Ian Brady. In fact, there was even photos of Myra posing on the victims' graves. A boy by the name of Tommy Radigan was actually supposed to be the couple's second victim. He was lured into their home by the promise of bread and jam, but after he arrived there, he could hear the couple fighting and just had an overall bad feeling. That is when he decided to escape out the window, but Myra Hindley had actually tried to chase him down, but fortunately he got away. Sadly, this took place just a week before John Kilbride was murdered. Ian Brady and Myra Hindley were put in jail for life, and originally only admitted to 3 of the 5 murders. They later admitted to all 5 murders and helped police track down Paulina's body, but unfortunately, Keith Bennett's body has never been found. Hindley died in 2002 and Brady died in 2017. And guys, that brings us to the end of this video. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and also comment down below if you have any suggestions on what you'd like to see in my future videos and don't forget to subscribe. And if you're new here, go check out the other videos on my channel once you're done watching this one. Thank you so much for watching and I'll see you in the next one. Bye guys!